Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to promote and strengthen traditional marriage. I encourage you to sign up for our free e-newsletter at the website, which has information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. This is the question and answer period following Baylor Law School's debate between Dr. J and Manuel Quinto-Pozos on the definition of marriage. If you missed their debate, grab the previous podcast.
Dr. Morris, you put a great deal of emphasis on the definition of marriage from a cultural, sociological, legal perspective. Are your observations in regard to public policy aspects of this issue the same if we were to be dealing with domestic partnership laws or the concept of civil unions, which of course set to the side the luggage, so to say, that is attached to the word marriage?
The issue with domestic partnerships and civil unions is both a policy issue and a kind of political issue, you might say. My personal position is that all of the legitimate practical problems that same-sex couples face can be resolved without redefining marriage. And civil unions is one vehicle for doing that. Second party adoption is a vehicle for doing that. There are a variety of legal tools that can be done without redefining marriage and in the concomitant way redefining parenthood, which is was the thrust of my remarks. As a matter of public policy or, you know, sort of political reality, the fact is that however much I or you or anyone in this room might think that civil unions is a good compromise, it has never been considered a good compromise by the advocates of the full redefinition of marriage. And so in California, we face this very interesting situation that the people of California had voted for very ample civil union protections for same-sex couples, and that was deemed to be not good enough, and a lawsuit was brought by the gay legal establishment, I suppose you'd say, to say that that wasn't good enough, to demand marriage rights, and that is what precipitated Proposition 8. That's what woke the sleeping giant of the people of California. And whereas civil partnerships, that all of that stuff just sailed through without anybody even paying any attention. So I think it's very interesting to note that what might seem like a compromise by one side appears to be nothing but a stepping stone for the other side. And I think that's something that now that that has happened, now that we have that history of that happening a couple of times, not just in California, but a couple of times, I think people are more reluctant to go along with domestic partnerships for that reason. I think it's kind of unfortunate, actually.
Thank you, Mr. Quinto-Pozos. You have indicated that marriage historically has had a malleable definition. Given that, when we look at domestic partnerships and civil unions, we're talking about, of course, terminology in a sense. Are we talking about something more than that?
Yes. I agree with Dr. J that many of the challenges and unequal status to which same-sex couples are subjected to because of marriage inequality could be resolved or could be addressed by implementing domestic partnerships or civil unions. However, that I have two responses to that. Number one, a good number of the rights and responsibilities that attach to marriage come from the federal government. I think there has been an accounting of the number of federal statutes that depend on spouses' status as married to each other, and the count is over 1,100 different statutes that mention spouses. And so domestic partnerships and civil unions do not achieve full equality for same-sex couples. And then there's also the idea that was very prevalent in the Proposition 8 case that Dr. J cited earlier, that this is not a perfect analogy, but that amounts to having separate but allegedly equal institutions. And I think we all recognize that there's a special significance, there's a special meaning to having a marriage and to having somebody that you can call your husband or your wife. And it's not just about labels. It's about a status. And so having civil unions and having domestic partnerships is not a full way to address the situation.
Thank you. Questions now? And this is directed to either of you who'd like to lead off. If marriage is really about children, why do we extend marriage to those who are plainly cannot have children, such as those past childbearing age?
I suppose that's for me, principally. The point is that when two little old people get married in the nursing home, there's nothing about their union that in any way undermines the essential public purpose of marriage. And in fact, in many ways, the two little old people holding hands in the nursing home, deciding that they really ought to get married because it would be scandalous if they didn't, they're kind of supporting the institution of marriage by doing that. But as I have shown, for to take away the gender-based requirement for marriage fundamentally changes what marriage does, which is it changes the way in which children are going to get attached to their parents. So when my opponent cited the fact that same-sex couples have legal responsibility for children, he glided over the fact that some of those children are obviously not attached to both of their biological parents, and some, I think, that the fair thing to do, the just thing to do, the honest thing to do, is not to glide over the attachment of children to parents who are not, to people who are not their biological parents, but to make explicit exactly what you're doing, which is to say you're doing an adoption. In effect, you're doing an adoption, and I think that should be made explicit so that the mother knows that that's what she's doing, so that the bio parent knows that that's what she's doing, so that the non-bio parent knows that that's what they're doing, and in that sense, it is not separate but unequal here. This is not a separate but equal kind of argument. It's simply taking account of the fact that there is something different going on between the way a same-sex couple becomes parents and the way an opposite-sex couple becomes parents, and there's no discrimination in paying attention to that fact and to having some legal recognition of it and devising legal institutions that are appropriate to that situation. That, I think, is what's at stake, and that, you'll notice, is what my opponent really didn't address in any way in his remarks.
Mr. Quinto-Pozos, would you like to respond?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that we recognize the marriage between an elderly couple who can't have children because marriage can be about children, but it's not always, as I said during my comments. And I was criticized for not offering my definition of marriage. I would have to say that I largely agree with Judge Walker's definition of marriage, even though it didn't mention children, even though it didn't mention sex. I would definitely add those aspects as optional, perhaps, elements of marriage. And I think that when two elderly people get married, I agree that that is a reinforcement of the institution of marriage. Now, I don't know how allowing people of different sex is not also a reinforcement and an honoring to the institution of marriage. Gay people are trying to achieve something that opposite sex couples have been allowed to achieve for a long time. And I think that that is, in and of itself, a way to recognize the significance of marriage.
Thank you. Mr. Quinto-Pozos, I think this question is for you. Do you support amending the United States Constitution to define marriage? Is such an amendment necessary, or would something short of an eventual constitutional amendment suffice?
I don't think that it's necessary to amend the U.S. Constitution to achieve marriage equality. I think that we already have the legal tools to achieve marriage equality under our current constitution. And as you mentioned during your opening comments, that marriage equality has been achieved in some states by legislative action. I don't think an amendment allowing same-sex marriage or redefining same-sex marriage is necessary. And frankly, I believe it would be politically impossible in our current environment.
Dr. Barr is the converse of that question. The constitutional amendments that have been proposed, of course, overwhelmingly go in the other direction of defining traditional marriage. Is the public policy rationale of the spouse served by anything short of an eventual amendment?
Well, I think that given the current political climate, I think it would be a very good thing to have a federal marriage amendment. And the reason I think that is precisely because when challenged, my opponent basically said that the reason separate but equal doesn't work is because of all the federal issues. And then all of the, I'm not a lawyer, so I don't know the legal term, as you go from one state to another recognizing the marriages of another state. So I think we've already seen that part of the strategy here is to have is to redefine marriage in one state and try to use that as a way of redefining it throughout the states. And so I think that I think sooner or later, one way or the other, there's going to be a federal policy. There's going to be a national policy. And the reason I think that a federal marriage amendment would be a good idea is that whenever the people of the United States have had a chance to vote on the subject of marriage, they have voted overwhelmingly in favor of the traditional definition of marriage. And so your catalog of how, gee, it really looks like we're all going to end up with same-sex marriage eventually, you know, that assumes that what's going to happen is you're going to have a series of legal cases. But if you have a series of votes, it's not so clear what that will be. And so I think that I think a federal marriage amendment would be a good thing and is probably necessary. And unlike my opponent, I think our side could win it.
Dr. Morris, this question is for you. I know a family of two gay fathers and two gay mothers who used artificial insemination to have children who are biologically related to the parents. Two sets of parents are close, and the children spend equal time with each of them. How does this kind of family fit into your rationale that gay marriage does not further the underlying, or as it's said here, American purpose of marriage?
Okay, I'm glad whoever brought this up brought it up, because this is a very important observation. The fact is that, in a sense, these sets of parents are connected to one another through their children here, okay? And so when people say to us that redefining marriage is only a small thing, that you're just opening up the institution of marriage to include people who are currently excluded, I think we need to see that a case like this shows that it's not a small thing. Instead of a child having two parents, the biological mother and the biological father as their legal parents and their only legal parents, we now have children with four legal parents. And I think that this is a big thing. Okay, this is a big difference, and it's happening as a byproduct of the idea that we have to allow everybody. We have to allow adults to do whatever they want. And you know, the basic rule now in artificial reproductive technology is that anybody with money gets to do anything they want. And I think very few people, if they really thought about that whole industry and what it does and what it's responsible for, I think very few people would really want that as the moral rule, as the moral standard. But that's where we're coming. That's what it's coming to. And so there really is a lot more at stake than just two people and how they feel about each other. The idea that a child can have four legal parents, I think, is something that deserves a lot more careful, serious thought than we have given it so far. And I would just point out to you that the divorce rate being what it is in this country, if you've got four parents in effect who are trying to manage some kind of relationship among one another, I mean, this is all well and good as long as everybody's getting along. But if one of those couples divorces one another, if the couples cease to get along with one another, you know, the opportunity for conflict is simply multiplies by the number of bilateral relationships that you have. It's all well and good to say, oh, gee, it's going to be swell because a kid has four people who love them. But that's not how it's always going to go. And there's also a lot of evidence we didn't get a chance to talk about. My opponent brought up some of the studies, but there's a whole body of research that shows that biological parents and step-parents behave differently towards their children. And, you know, it's not that step-parents are bad people. It's just that it's asking a lot to ask somebody who's not biologically related to the child to behave in the same way as they would if they are. And, again, some of you may have had that experience in your own life. And so that whole body of evidence, which is pretty robust evidence, you know, it's a lot of studies on that subject, We're just supposed to ignore all of that and assume that it's all going to be good. I think that's really asking a lot, and I'm not optimistic about the future of such arrangements.
Mr. King, Quinto-Pozos, would you like to respond, especially to the latter comments regarding step parents?
So to respond to that, first, I am familiar, or I have heard of studies that conclude that step parents are not as good at parenting stepchildren as biological parents are at raising biological children. And I haven't read the studies, I don't know the methodologies or anything like that, and so I have really no basis to disagree with that conclusion. What I would point out, though, is that if we're talking about the same study, that study did not look at sexual orientation at all. My additional response to that is that the conclusion would also support taking other measures against heterosexual step-parents. And so why is it okay for some non-biologically related parents to form these relationships with other people and with other children, as long as they're not gay? And that is, as I referred to earlier, I think that this comes back to a moral judgment against gay people and against gay relationships that is not backed up by evidence, for the most part. So that is my response to that point. In terms of a four-parent family, and if I understood this correctly, that's how I would describe it as well. We already have plenty of instances in our country taking sexual orientation and gay marriage out of the picture, in which families define themselves and their living units and their households in different ways. And to give you an example, my partner was raised in a house that had two biological parents, and it had an aunt and a son and a grandmother and a great-grandmother. And they were a family. They were a household. He was attached to all of them. He considered his cousin his brother. And what is wrong with that? I mean, that doesn't seek to redefine marriage. We, by and large, respect those family informal relationships. I would like to draw a parallel to that in response to that question. And I don't see anything wrong with that.
If I may respond to that briefly, I assure you that the grandmother and the great-grandmother did not have legal parental rights with respect to any of those children. And so the informal parenting rights and family relationships, that's not what's at stake here. Of course, that's very lovely if that works out. But that's not what's at stake here. Those children had two and only two parents. And likewise, in step-parent households, I assure you that the average stepfather or stepmother does not have legal parenting rights, particularly if the bio-dad or bio mom is still around, and in order for them to have legal parenting rights, some steps have to be taken. The marriage itself isn't enough to give legal parenting rights to those individuals. You have to release the rights from the other party and reattach them, do an adoption, and so on and so forth. And I think that's appropriate, and I think that standard is what should be applying here as well.
Dr. Morris, this is a question I do not believe is redundant. You put much emphasis upon the lack of prerogative of the state to redefine marriage, given its cultural, sociological, historical origins. The question here is stated very simply: how is a loving, committed same-sex couple different from a loving, committed heterosexual couple besides the physical characteristics?
Well, the point is, how are they different with respect to what? That's really the issue, what the issue comes down to, is with respect to what? The fact that they love one another, I don't think is a legal category, as far as I know. So the fact that they love one another, that's not in dispute. The fact that they're living together is not in dispute. The fact that they can make contracts with one another, that they can leave their property to one another, that they can share parenting. There are legal institutions that will allow them to share parenting with one another. So none of those things are on the table, as far as I'm concerned. What's on the table is the essential public purpose of marriage, and with respect to that essential public purpose of marriage, same-sex couples and opposite-sex couples are situated differently. And it's not good enough to say that, we can have biology and biological childbearing as one of the purposes of marriage. You'll notice Judge Walker didn't have it on his list. It's not like he's got a list of purposes and he just kind of moved that one down a few notches. He had to take it completely off the list, because if that is a government purpose, whether it's the first or the third or the 14th, if that is a valid government purpose and people are situated differently with respect to it, then you can treat them differently. And so he had to knock it off the list completely. And I think that's objectionable, to knock it off the list completely. I think that's going to have far-reaching ramifications, and that's what I'm concerned about. Contrary to what has been said, gayness per se is not a part of my argument. I don't think I challenge anyone here to listen to the tape of this remark and of my comments and hear me say anything about gayness per se, or whether gay people are fit or gay people are this or that or worthy or anything. I mean, it's not about gay people. And in fact, the gender-based requirement for marriage, actually, in a certain sense, isn't discriminatory at all, because when you go in to get a marriage license, they don't look at you and say, are you gay or straight? They don't care about that. All they want to know is, are you legally eligible to marry, and are you marrying somebody else that is legally eligible to marry, and is it a person of the opposite sex? They don't care whether you're gay or straight, right? And so you can say, well, that's only formal equality, and that doesn't count for anything, but really, I think it's important to see that equality is a very big and open-ended kind of notion, and we need to take responsibility for saying equal with respect to what? Equal in what way? Right? And so that's what I'm trying to focus the discussion on here. By one understanding of equality, you could say, well, we've already got marriage equality because they don't care. Nobody asks you whether you're gay or straight. But that's obviously not to the point of what people are talking about, but that, I think, shows the point that you have to be clear about what kind of equality you're actually talking about, and that there are lots of competing definitions of that.
Mr. Quinto-Pozos, I would like to allow you a couple minutes to respond to that response by Dr. Morris, and then, because Dr. Morris opened the debate tonight, to close the debate, we will have a closing argument by Mr. Quinto-Pozos, there will be a reply by Dr. Morris, and then conversely, a closing argument by Dr. Morris and a reply by Mr. Quinto-Pozos.
Are we doing responses to the closings?
Yes.
Oh, we are? No, I don't think so.
We can't.
Oh, he's in charge, actually. He is the ultimate authority here. I mean,
okay, so tell me the order again.
I'm trying to maintain some time fairness here. I'd like you to respond to Dr. Morris's last response, and then our timekeepers here will begin with your giving your closing argument. They'll give you the time, and Dr. Morris will respond, and then converse, and that will close. And then Bree and Andy will close the evening for us.
Okay. Going back to Judge Walker's definition of marriage and having children taken off the list, the rest of the opinion also recognizes, as I have said, that having children and the ability to have children and the ability to raise children can't be the sole reason for having a marriage. And this goes back, and I hope I'm not sounding like a broken record, even though I feel like I am. Some straight married couples don't have children, and that's okay. They are allowed to be married. And some unmarried, or perhaps married in some cases, same-sex couples do have and can raise children. So the fit is not really there between legal marriage and having children. And that is in large part what the opinion is about. And that's why it's not in the definition that he uses. And in response to it not being about sexual orientation or about gayness or being asked when you go get a marriage license whether you're gay or straight, that's true, but you know, that is sort of a that tries to get around the fact that what gay people, when a gay person wants to get married, he wants to get married to somebody of the same sex by definition. So I'm not asking for the right to get married to some straight woman because I don't want that. I know I already have that right. Not to demean that. So that is my response. In closing, I recognize and I wanted to elaborate on the fact that different religions and other different ethical and moral codes are entitled to view gay people and gay couples as different. However, I don't think that I don't agree with that particular perspective, but it's entitled to be there. And I don't think that should matter in our debate and today and in the larger debate in society. The moral beliefs of the majority should not be taken and translated into laws that the majority can then use to beat up the minority. Gay people and gay couples are just like everybody else in every way that is relevant to marriage. And popular attitudes about marriage are changing. Polls conducted by various news and research organizations have shown that the popular acceptance of marriage has been rising in recent years. I don't mean to be flippant, but like it or not, gay people will continue forming long-lasting bonds even without equal marriage rights. Like it or not, gay couples will continue naming their partners as beneficiaries in their wills and in their insurance policies, even at great personal financial cost, even without equal marriage rights. Like it or not, gay couples will continue executing powers of attorney, living wills, and other legal documents to try to secure their hospital visitation and end-of-life decision rights, even without equal marriage rights. Like it or not, gay people are going to keep having, adopting, and raising children even without marriage rights. But because marriage is good for straight couples and their children, and because marriage would be good for gay couples and our children too, it would make our lives so much easier to be treated as equals. Not only would it have no effect on heterosexual marriage, it would also send a message that all marriages, gay and straight alike, are valued and valuable institutions worthy of protection and emulation. Thank you.
Now, am I to respond to him? Is that what you want me to do? To respond to him and then to have a 5-minute closing? I'm not clear what you want me to do. Go, I respond to you. Okay, thank you. And I have like 3 minutes to do that, is that the idea? Okay. I will give you that having children is not the sole reason for people having marriage. It's not the sole reason why people get married. It's not the sole reason that anybody gets married. The issue isn't the private reasons why people get married. The issue is, why do we need a public institution of marriage in the first place? That's the point. And the kinds of things that you've been talking about, the kinds of things that Judge Walker has been talking about, those things can be accomplished without an institution of marriage that is presumptively permanent, presumptively monogamous, lifelong union. The reason we have the institution of marriage in the first place that has these characteristics does in fact come from the fact that heterosexual unions produce children, and we need to take responsibility for those children. So therefore, the institution of marriage has a kind of structure to it. It has a kind of natural form to it, a kind of natural structure to it. And it's simply not the case, and I think I've already shown that this is not the case, that redefining marriage to take out the gender requirement, to take out the even the concept of children as being a purpose of marriage, is in fact to redefine marriage. And that's why this is an important issue. It's not just that we're going to have same-sex couples over here and opposite-sex couples over here and it's all going to be fine, because what's happening is you've redefined the institution of marriage for everyone, just like the redefining the permanence issue through no-fault divorce did not just affect the handful of people who at that time felt like they wanted to get divorced. It changed the incentives for everybody. It changed the incentives for getting divorced. It changed the incentives for getting married in the first place. It had far-reaching ramifications. So I will tell you flat out, if we redefine marriage so that there's only so that there's no gender requirement, there are going to be people who are not gay who are going to get married because of some reason. They're going to have some reason, whatever their reason might be, because in their mind that's going to be, you know, the optimal thing to do. So what you've done is you've changed the incentives for everyone, not just the 3% of the population that currently defines itself as gay. So you have to think that through. What are we setting into motion here as we take out this basic structural feature of what is marriage and what does in fact have a public purpose of marriage apart from any private purposes? And I would like to just say one word on behalf of the children. That children, my argument is not about who has good parenting skills, and you never heard that from me. He brought up these studies. It's not about who has good parenting skills. All kind of people have a good and appropriate parenting skills. The argument is about who are you connected to? What is your heritage? Who are you? And if you want to look at some studies, if you want to really think this through, I would commend to you that you start looking at the studies of those who were donor-conceived persons. Persons who were conceived through anonymous sperm donors are now growing up and they're speaking for themselves. They have their own websites where they're talking about what it was like to find out that their dad wasn't their dad, or what it was like to find out that they were partially purchased. All of those kinds of feelings are very complicated, and I would really urge you to look at what these people have to say and look at the kind of experience that they're having before you just write it off and say that this is unimportant and that their rights don't deserve any consideration.
Mr. Quinto-Pozos, you have the last concluding remarks.
For how long? Okay. Yes, some people will get married for reasons other than long-term commitment, love, etc. But that is already happening. That is already happening with straight couples. And I really think that we have to be consistent here. And that is also a point in response to the last remarks about children conceived by artificial insemination. That doesn't just happen with gay parents. It happens with straight parents. And so, and I don't demean or question the feelings that these children had, but why is that a reason to keep gay people out of marriage and to keep same-sex parents from being in a committed long-term union that has rights as a couple and as parents? I think that consistency is a big question here. So that is my response to those comments.
You've just been listening to Dr. J and Manuel Quinto-Pozos taking questions after debating the definition of marriage at Baylor Law School. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Robeck Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.libsyn.com and iTunes. And as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love.